Macmillan Audio presents Madly Deeply, The Diaries of Alan Rickman by Alan Rickman. Edited by Alan Taylor. Narrated for you by Steven Crossley, Alfred Enoch, Bonnie Wright, and Rima Horton.
Foreword by Emma Thompson. The most remarkable thing about the first days after Alan died was the number of actors, poets, musicians, playwrights, and directors who wanted to express their gratitude for all the help he'd given them. I don't think I know anyone in this business who has championed more aspiring artists, nor unerringly perceived so many great ones before they became great. Quite a number said that latterly they had been too shy to thank him personally. They had found it hard to approach him. Of all the contradictions in my blissfully contradictory friend, this is perhaps the greatest. This combination of profoundly nurturing and imperturbably distant. He was not, of course, distant. He was alarmingly present at all times. The inscrutability was partly a protective shield. If anyone did approach him with anything like gratitude, or even just a question, they would be greeted with a depth of sweetness that no one who didn't know him could even guess at. And he was not, of course, unflappable. I could flap him like nobody's business, and when I did, he was fierce with me, and it did me no end of good. He was generous and challenging, dangerous and comical, sexy and androgynous, virile and peculiar, temperamental and languid, fastidious and casual. My list is endless. I'm sure you can add to it. There was something of the sage about him, and had he had more confidence and been at all corruptible, he could probably have started his own religion. His taste in all things from sausages to furnishings appeared to me to be impeccable. His generosity of spirit was unsurpassed, and he had so much time for people that I used to wonder if he ever slept or ever got time for himself. A word not traditionally associated with Alan is gleeful, but when he was genuinely amused, he was absolutely the essence of glee. There would be a holding back as the moment built, and then a sudden leaning forward and swinging round of the torso as a vast, impish grin flowered, sometimes accompanied by an inarticulate shout of laughter. It was almost as if he was surprised by himself. It was my life's mission to provoke those moments. I remember Imelda Staunton nearly killing him by telling him a story about my mother and an unfortunate incident with some hashish. I have never seen him laugh more, before or since. It was a bit like watching someone tickling the Sphinx. One Christmas Eve party, I had a sprig of mistletoe hanging up at home. I was loitering under it and turned to find Alan bearing down on me. I lifted my chin up hopefully. He smiled and approached. I puckered. He leaned in under the mistletoe, and a sudden change came over his face. His eyes started to glitter and his nostrils quiver. He lifted up a hand, reached in, and pulled a longish hair out of my chin. "Ouch," I said. "That's an incipient beard," he said, handing me the hair and walking off. That was the thing about Alan. You never knew if you were going to be kissed or unsettled, but you couldn't wait to see what would come next. The trouble with death is there is no next. There is only what was, and for that I am profoundly and heartbrokenly grateful. The last thing we did together was change a plug on a standard lamp in his hospital room. The task went the same way as everything we have ever done together. I had a go, he told me to try something else. I tried, and it didn't work, so he had a go. I got impatient and took it from him, and tried again, and it still wasn't right. We both got slightly irritable. Then he patiently took it all apart again and got the right lead into the right hole. I screwed it in. We complained about how fiddly it was. Then we had a cup of tea. It took us at least half an hour. He said afterwards, "Well, it's a good thing I decided not to be an electrician." I am still heartbroken that Alan is gone, but these diaries bring back so much of what I remember of him. There is that sweetness I mentioned, his generosity, his championing of others, his fierce critical eye, his intelligence, his humor. Alan was the ultimate ally in life, art, and politics. I trusted him absolutely. He was, above all things, a rare and unique human being, and we shall not see his like again. Emma Thompson.
Introduction. Moviegoers caught their first sight of Alan Rickman in 1988 in the action thriller Die Hard. At the age of 42, antediluvian by Hollywood standards, he was cast as Hans Gruber, a Teutonic terrorist who has seized control of a Los Angeles skyscraper and taken hostages. So far, so unremarkable. Expectations for the film were modest and early reviews mixed. This, though, did nothing to dent its popularity at the box office, which grew by word of mouth. Starring Bruce Willis as an NYPD detective, Gruber's nemesis, Die Hard alerted audiences around the globe to the talented Mr. Rickman, whose devil-may-care interpretation of a psychopath stole the show and received a deluge of plaudits. As a New Yorker critic later noted, Gruber likes nice suits, reads magazines, misquotes Plutarch. No one ever looked so brilliantly uninterested while firing a machine gun or executing a civilian. As portrayed by Rickman, Gruber seems to possess a strange fatalism, as if he expects to lose and to die all along. Lord Byron quipped that after the publication of his poem Childe Harold, he awoke one morning and found himself famous. The same might be said of Alan Rickman and Die Hard. Until then, his career had largely been forged in Britain, most notably at the Royal Shakespeare Company, where, in 1985, he stood out in plays such as Les Liaisons Dangereuses. But before then, in 1982, he appeared on BBC television in a series adapted from Anthony Trollope's Barchester novels. Perfectly cast as the Reverend Obadiah Slope, a slimy hypocrite with a toe-curling smile, Alan demonstrated that he was as at home on screen as he was on the stage. Global stardom may have taken its time to embrace him, but there was surely never any doubt that it would eventually do so. Blessed with a voice that could make fluctuations on the stock market sound seductive, and a delivery that was hypnotically unhurried, it was obvious that Alan had a natural gift for acting. To him, it was more a vocation than a profession, and he was irked by those who sought to disparage it and in awe of anyone who devoted their life to it. As his diaries demonstrate, acting is not merely a means of escape, in itself a wondrous thing, but a portal to a greater understanding of what it means to be human. However, it was not how he originally sought to make a living. Born in 1946 in the London working-class suburb of Acton, Alan Sidney Patrick Rickman was the second of four children, three boys and one girl. His father, Bernard, was a factory worker who died when Alan was eight. It was thus left to his mother, Margaret, who worked as a telephonist, to bring up the family. He was educated at a local primary school and Latimer Upper, which counts among its alumni the actors Hugh Grant and Mel Smith. He met Rima Horton when she was 15 and he was a year older. Both were keen on amateur dramatics. Friends for several years, they became a couple around 1970 and remained together for the rest of Alan's life, marrying in 2012. On leaving school, he attended Chelsea College of Art and Design, graduating in 1968. After a few years working as a graphic designer, he won a scholarship to the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art. It was at RADA, where he was recognized as one of the top students, that his future life was defined. As he wrote in 1974, Fine acting always hits an audience with the force and oneness of the well-aimed bomb. One is only aware of the blast or series of blasts at the time. Afterwards, you can study the devastation or think about how a bomb is made. Alan's apprenticeship was served in repertory theatre, in towns and cities like Sheffield, Birmingham, Nottingham and Glasgow, where he could hone his craft and gain experience. It was his equivalent of a Swiss finishing school and gave him a solid bedrock on which to build. It meant, too, that when he made the breakthrough as a star, he never lost touch with his roots or his sense of perspective. Following Die Hard, he was in constant demand. First came Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, in which he was unforgettable as the Sheriff of Nottingham. That's it then. Cancel the kitchen scraps for lepers and orphans, no more merciful beheadings, and call off Christmas. Always wary of being typecast, especially as a villain, his next role was in the romantic comedy Truly, Madly, Deeply, opposite Juliet Stevenson. She was one of a number of female actors whom he counted as close friends. In 1995, he appeared in An Awfully Big Adventure, an adaptation of Beryl Bainbridge's novel of the same title, and Sense and Sensibility, which Emma Thompson adapted from Jane Austen's classic novel. Galaxy Quest, a parody of Star Trek, which has since acquired cult status, required him to play an alien, while in Dogma, he was an angel who has the voice of God. Alan was nothing, if not versatile. Other roles included Rasputin, Anton Mesmer, Eamon de Valera, and Hilly Crystal, owner of the legendary New York punk rock club CBGB. The first decade of the new century was devoted largely to the Harry Potter series of 8 films. He played Severus Snape, the famously grumpy professor with a ready wit, a part with which he became synonymous and which reduced considerably the average age of his burgeoning fanbase. On learning that I was editing Alan's diaries, my 8-year-old granddaughter was suitably and unusually impressed. As the diaries demonstrate, Alan was ever eager to test himself and rarely chose an easy option. He set his bar high, and if he suffered fools, it was through clenched teeth. He demanded as much of himself as he did of others. A case in point is the 1998 production at the National Theatre of Antony and Cleopatra, with Helen Mirren as the voluptuous enchantress of the Nile and Alan as her befuddled, besotted suitor. In another existence, he might have devoted himself to directing. His production of Sharman MacDonald's play, The Winter Guest, in the theatre and as a movie, remained among his proudest achievements. My Name is Rachel Corrie was another such highlight. Based on the journals and letters of the eponymous heroine, who was killed by an Israeli armoured bulldozer while protesting against the demolition of Palestinian homes, the show, which he co-wrote with the journalist Catherine Viner, was postponed on the eve of its transfer to New York because of alleged anti-Israeli bias. It was a charge Alan vehemently denied. Less controversial was the movie A Little Chaos, about a gardener, Kate Winslet, who is employed by Louis XIV of France, Alan. Long in gestation, it finally appeared in 2014. Given such a catalogue of credits, it might be assumed that Alan's dedication to his work eclipsed all else. Nothing could be further from the truth. He was devoted to his family and friends and was renowned for his gregariousness, kindness, honesty, and generosity. Should anyone attempt to pay for a meal, they were often rebuffed with 2 words, Harry and Potter. Few were the days he did not dine out. When not in London, he was often in New York, where he and Rima had an apartment, or the Tuscan town of Campagnatico, where they restored a house. Favoured holiday destinations were the Caribbean and South Africa. If not on stage himself, he was assiduous in attending shows in which his peers were appearing. It was his habit to take notes and offer advice, which was mostly received in the manner in which it was given. Brian Cox recalled that while they were performing in the 1980 television adaptation of Zola's Thérèse Raquin, Alan told him that he was being rather slow in picking up your cues. Alan, replied Cox, do you realize how long it took you to say that? You call me slow. You are the master. Such testimony is legion, as was the love Alan engendered. It is worth bearing in mind that when in his diaries he is critical of friends, it was born of love. Moreover, we can safely assume that what he wrote, he was also prepared to say face to face. Why he kept a diary is unclear. Diarists come in all shapes, and their reasons for recording their lives are similarly diverse. Some people want to bear witness to earth-shattering events, while others are content to detail what appears to be trivia, but which, with the passage of time, acquires enduring significance. We do not know whether Alan would like to have seen his diaries published, but he did receive invitations to write books which could have drawn upon the material in them. What we do know is that once he started writing a diary, it became addictive. From 1972, he kept a pocket diary in which he noted appointments, anniversaries, opening nights, and addresses. 27 of these remain. In 1992, he started to produce a much fuller account of his life and work and bought diaries from a local stationer's, which gave him a page per day to play with. These number 26 volumes, several of which are colourfully and beautifully illustrated. In addition, there is a notebook kept from the mid-1970s to the mid-1980s, to which he added whenever he felt the urge. He made his last entry on the 12th of December, 2015, by when he knew he did not have long to live. Madly Deeply is a distillation of more than a million words. It tells the story of what it meant to be one of the most feted and admired actors in the decades immediately before and after the dawn of the third millennium. There are highs and lows, glowing reviews and bad, performances that were a joy and others when it seemed that everything that could go wrong did. After the applause and the encores, Alan would repair to a favoured late-night haunt where, surrounded by well-wishers and fellow actors, he would unwind and think about the show just gone and the shows yet to come. Reading this book is as close as we can get to being there ourselves and to encountering the real Alan Rickman. What a privilege it is to spend time in his company. By Alan Taylor. 1993. Patrick Caulfield, Richard Wilson, Lake District, Radio Sussex, Berlin, Riverside Studios, Mesmer, Peter Sellers's The Persians, Salzburg, Neil Kinnock, Vienna, Steve Reich, Sleepless in Seattle, Vienna, Mesmer, Berlin, Hungary, Paris, Arts Rally, Felix Awards.
The 13th of June. Quiet pleasure of preparing food for friends. 1 p.m. Michael G., Christopher and Laura Hampton, Danny and Leela Webb, Jane and Mark, and Rima and Lily. The sun emerged, and we spilled into the garden. The 20th of June. Patrick Caulfield, who says he hates painting, but it's how he earns a living. The horror of walking into this small room. Important to do something. Doesn't matter what, just something. The 21st of June. Arrive home, switch on BBC Two. Pina Bausch. The real thing. After reading another article in The Face about hot young things. She has such a graceful, determined truthfulness. And Robert Lepage pays homage. Of course. The 23rd of June. 12-ish. Midland Bank to talk of possible house purchase. 1-ish. David Coppard. Movies, taxes, arrangements, expenses. How does he retain his charm?
Footnote. David Coppard, Alan's accountant.
4-ish. Belinda Lang and her husband, Hugh Fraser. Lily's birthday. But she's sick. Apparently, I upset Elaine Page on election day. My casual cruelty again. The 24th of June. Finish Christopher Hampton's Nostromo script. How do you cram that book into a movie? Maybe he has. I don't know. A morning on the phone. How few real conversations there are. Mainly a desire to present a moving target. 12.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.